In this podcast, Gray Cook joins John Russin of TNation.com to answer some tough questions about FMS and CrossFit.
Hey guys, Dr. John Russin here with Testosterone Nation. Today we have a very exciting interview coming to you guys. We have Gray Cook, the founder and originator of the Functional Movement Systems, here with us.
Thank you, John. Thank you. It's really good to be here.
We're a couple weeks away from the CrossFit Games, and the big question that everyone wants to know is, what are your thoughts on the current system in CrossFit for the initial athlete screenings to identify potential risk factors of movement that could possibly lead to injuries?
Well, to be honest, I don't currently think CrossFit has a systematic tool for doing that. But let's be honest, John, I don't know if any one group has that systematic tool. I think some of the things that a lot of people criticize in CrossFit are simply endemic or actual problems that have always been in fitness for maybe even the last 30 years, but CrossFit has accelerated everything. They've accelerated exposure to new and innovative body weight and Olympic type lifting techniques and kettlebells and stuff. So a lot of people learned about old and new tools for fitness through CrossFit. So all I think we really saw is the evolution of modern fitness on fast forward. And so some of those problems rise to the surface, but I don't really think it's a CrossFit problem. I think that the average consumer of fitness may not know how best to consume that diet of fitness. Meaning, I think most of us who coach or teach or train, we give it to you in layers. We must establish health. Then we must establish a movement integrity or movement literacy. Now I'm worried about your physical capacity. And lastly, now let's talk about skill development and physical development in a particular direction. Any one of those layers has a crack in it or a flaw in it, you may actually be trying to address a problem that goes far deeper than you think. So I think CrossFit has simply given us an opportunity to really discuss this in a model that I think could potentially, with a little bit of systemization, be the vehicle for how we actually change physical education in our country. So I got nothing bad to say, except when you get big and you get popular, install some systematic approaches so everything you're doing is sustainable.
Yeah, there's no doubt about that, Gray. And really, CrossFit has innovated at such an exponential rate that it's hard to keep up, especially from a system standpoint. You know, they've done a really great job at their level one, level two certifications. Is that something that you think a systemized movement screen of some sort could fit into eventually?
I think if CrossFit would simply frame the whole movement screen as an intake strategy that will give you a competitive advantage. Now, you know, a lot of us can say, well, you know, it might be used for injury prevention, but I would like to take a positive spin and say, listen, if you give me 40 people with no fitness background whatsoever, and I got to get them ready to deliver fitness to consumers, I think that's, if there's any one thing I think I can do probably better than my peers, it's take inexperienced fitness people and say, here's a standard operating procedure. Don't go to step two until you check all the boxes in step one. If you can't, kick it out of the system and process everybody else.
Absolutely. So since CrossFit is largely considered the king of all fitness sports in current day America and beyond, how could the FMS potentially fit into the CrossFit system?
I think the way it fits in is when you're either intaking a new CrossFit consumer or you're sort of reappraising the things that have occurred in a CrossFit box for this particular consumer. Obviously, we want to go to those physical performance metrics and see how big, fast, or strong you've become. But at the same time, if your cholesterol went up, or your testosterone crashed, or you developed an arrhythmia in your heart, then you would basically say, well, man, those gains actually might have interfered with my health. The movement screen is simply a little gauge we run in the background to see if your movement integrity dropped below a certain point. And if you're broken, if you can't intake information or process information, at least at an average level, then talking to you about technique will basically be me speaking Spanish if English is your only language. You're just not going to get much of what I'm doing, even though what I'm saying is right, you're not going to get much of it. So if the organism cannot adequately process the information in a tight feedback loop, then the screen is designed to pick that up and say these mobility and stability problems are going to impede the teaching platform that you're currently standing on. If you will correct these, or at least find out what's causing these, and in the same amount of time, just not persist in loading these. There's plenty of movement patterns you can load, but one that basically is considered dysfunctional on the screen, the best evidence says don't load it. Number one, yes, it could become injured, but number two, no good quick adaptation will occur here, because positive physical adaptation is based on one thing that nobody tracks, and that's a positive physical response. So when we do a corrective exercise, if you don't move better immediately after that corrective exercise, you did not get a positive response. We should not assume a positive adaptation. Where in the said principle, when we're adding muscle tissue or hoping for greater bone density or tendon strength, we got to wait for a while. We got to wait 3 to 6 weeks for that to occur. Whereas when we correct a movement pattern, the feedback loop is quick. Therefore, you know if it's a mobility or stability problem and what to do. But we should not assume superior adaptation if we cannot get an adequate or respectable response in a given movement situation. So, you know, the first thing the screen does is say, do we just need to tighten the coaching training environment? Do we need to create a different training environment? Or is this organism just going to respond slower in all environments? Because it can't hear, it can't see, or it can't feel dorsiflexion.
Well, I think that analogy with the organism versus the environment and which one is truly at fault is a huge example of the CrossFit system right now. How does CrossFit minimize the potential damage caused by the environment of the daily WODs for most people participating in the sport and the consistent competitive factors that go into nearly every session when you walk into a CrossFit box?
Well, Let me create a sidebar analogy and just let that run. If we get off of exercise for a minute, because I think everybody in touch with this this article is going to be very, very empowered and inspired by physical development. Let's get off of that for a minute and run a parallel and see if it clarifies our thinking. What if I had a website that was designed to expose you to food sources and combinations that you may have never seen before? We call it the meal of the day. Now, you actually have a chef at this kitchen who is directly in touch with the meal of the day that's coming down from the grand kitchen. And every day you get to stop by, and the whole intent of this meal of the day is not to tell you the portion size or force feed you anything. It's to simply expose you to things you're very familiar with and should probably try in these portions, in this way, in these combinations, or things that you may be completely unfamiliar with. If you don't know that you have food allergies, little bites might be the best way to start. If you know you do have a peanut allergy and the meal of the day involves peanuts, I think you're okay picking a peanut substitute. Now, if we're back over an exercise and you know for a fact that your squatting form is horrible, you've basically had an ankle problem for years, nobody's been able to solve it. Whenever I say squat, you hear deadlift, because you can deadlift with a stiff ankle, but you can't squat with a stiff ankle. So if we simply quit bantering back and forth about the workout of the day and realize the workout of the day is first and foremost to expose you to opportunities and exercise that you may not have considered, number one, new exercises, and number two, new and innovative combinations. If we simply take that away and then say, okay, how much of this fits with my personal goal of what I want to do today? If I simply take it as a challenge, then I'm playing the mobility WOD today, and I'm going to try to compete against something, hopefully with an adequate amount of training. But if my whole goal at the end of this summer is to run a 10K, then what I'm going to do with the workout of the day is look at everything that I could do to participate in this tribe that I'm in, but that's also going to leverage maybe the endurance and speed components. So I may get lighter weights. I may modify. So I think if we were sending down the meal of the day, every one of us would know enough about ourselves where we could modify that meal so that we wouldn't feel stuffed or unsatisfied, or so we wouldn't eat a food substance that we already know might create a dilemma. Why can't we do that with exercise? Why can't we basically know enough about ourselves to modify the workout of the day so that basically it allows us to still be part of the tribe and yet consume it in a way that we know is sustainable?
Yeah, and I love that analogy of the food meal of the day and somebody potentially being allergic to one of those things in the meal. And you know, that goes back to, is keeping the key athletes healthy and minimizing the controllable risk factors of training really centered around progressions and regressions of higher level movements within those WODs?
The one question I like to ask the people who really embrace CrossFit is just remember this, is the workout of the day to expose you to new exercises and new combinations, or is it to make you follow sets and rep packages to the letter or to the volume, even if you may not be prepared? And I think most of the intuitive spirits that really embrace CrossFit and feel it's a vehicle to maybe change the physical landscape of this country would definitely take one. If you could only choose one, our job is to expose you to new exercises and new combinations, not necessarily to force feed numeric packages that may not be appropriate for your skill set or conditioning level. And I think it's logical. It's absolutely logical if we think about, you know, if we're looking at CrossFit as simply another vehicle for physical education, adult physical education, then the most important thing is exactly what play does for us when we're teaching ourselves how to move as babies. The first thing we need is engagement. I want to be interested in what you're doing. But most kids play at their own pace. Nobody forces kids onto play packages. The minute you start doing that, they quit playing. So that exposure to something new or a new combination of something old is the brilliance in a workout of the day coming down line. Then the reason there are boxes, the reason there's somebody who knows your first and last name and knows what your health history is they help you modify that so that you can participate, but at a pace that allows you to be independent and sustain it for tomorrow.
Yeah, and like you said, you know, Kelly Starrett does just an amazing job of preaching the continuous assessment and evaluation and really using movement as a self-diagnosis every single time that you move. And there's got to be a big difference between going in and figuring out in one WOD that, hey, I don't have the movement capacity to overhead squat today, especially under high metabolic fatigue, and doing that same faulty movement pattern over and over, week after week, month after month, until something breaks down.
Listen, we hate tests. However, an F doesn't hurt unless you let it hurt. Now, an ACL hurts really bad, but an F, okay, or a 0 or a 1 on my FMS lunge, it doesn't hurt anybody. It just simply injures my pride, but it's not even for that. It's to alert you that, listen, a test basically says if you progress further in this environment, you're going to have so many failures that you won't be able to turn it into success. The feedback loop of failure will be so burdensome that you won't learn anything from it. So when we come out with the FMS and we do something that a lot of people have never done in exercise, if you can't pass this test, don't do that move. People are a little bit hurt and offended because they think we're saying never. You know how many runners have come through my clinic? I'm like, you can't run for 2 weeks. What they heard me say is, you got to sit in a chair for 2 weeks. Didn't say you couldn't bike. Didn't say you couldn't tread water. Didn't say we couldn't do core or upper body. I said impact is basically going to keep your problem alive for 2 weeks. The temporary disloading of a bad pattern that I think has become some of the things that we say in FMS has gotten blown up into, these people don't even want you exercising or lifting or going heavy. You know, I'm one of the few physical therapists that actually went through the early RKC and stood in front of Pavel and the guys and did my snatch test. I love going heavy. I love hitting it hard. I love badass forms of demonstration of superior physical development. I'm basically saying I love the CrossFit Games. But the path to get to that is a lot smarter path. The people who make it to that level, they got good strategy. They're playing it smart. They don't train on a day when their physical systems are shot. They know just as much about rest and regen as they do about lifting technique and metabolic packages. And so it's that smart play that gets you to the next level.
Yeah, and the advancement of the top 1% in the CrossFit sport has just been amazing to see, obviously on the big stage on ESPN every year. But what worries me are not the 1%ers, but the 99%ers.
For more on this and other great topics, visit functionalmovement.com.